In today's video, we're covering one of my favorite topics, and that is travel hacking. I've saved thousands of dollars on travel just by learning about travel hacking. $18,900 this year to be exact. And in this video, I'm going to be teaching you how you can do the exact same thing. Specifically, I'll give you a basic overview of how to travel using credit card points, and then I'll give you the basic tips that you need to get started. And finally, I'll walk you through my step-by-step process for redeeming flights. Hi, my name is Erica, and welcome to my channel. I'm a lawyer, but my passion is personal finance. So if you're interested in weekly personal finance tips, please do subscribe below. So first, let's go over the basics. I've made this video with the complete beginner in mind. So I'll go over the tips that I think every beginner should know before getting started with travel hacking. If you aren't a beginner, I'll put the timestamps in the description below so you can skip to the parts that might be relevant to you. So the basic concept of travel hacking is instead of using your hard-earned dollars to pay for flights and hotels, you're using points that you accumulate on credit cards instead and redeeming those points for free flights and hotels. I can't tell you how much I love travel hacking. I did the quick math and this year I've saved $18,900 on travel. These are the flights that I redeemed using credit card points. Two business class flights from Tokyo to the Maldives round trip, two economy flights from Tokyo to Sweden round trip, two economy flights from Okinawa to DC round trip, two business class flights from Tokyo to Hanoi round trip, and a few others, for a total of $18,900 in savings. So how do you get credit card points? There are two primary ways to get credit card points that I want to focus on in this video. One, you can get these points from sign-up bonuses that credit cards offer. To get these credit card sign-up bonuses, you typically have to spend a certain amount on the credit card within a specified time frame. For Chase Sapphire Preferred, for example, you have to spend $4,000 on the card within the first 3 months of opening in order to earn 60,000 points. Sign-up bonuses are going to be your best way to get a lot of points with relatively minimal spending. Using the Chase Sapphire Preferred example, if you wanted to earn those same 60,000 points through everyday spending, you'd have to spend between $30,000 to $60,000 on your credit card. The lower end of that, $30,000, assumes you're only spending on travel and dining, which gets you 2 points for every dollar that you spend. The higher end of that, $60,000, assumes that you're spending on other purchases, which get you 1 point for every dollar you spend. So this just goes to show just how lucrative these sign-up bonuses are. So apart from sign-up bonuses, the other way that you can earn points on these cards is by spending just as you normally would. Different cards will have a different amount of points that you'll earn for every dollar you spend. So to explain what I mean, I'll just take you through a few examples. The Capital One Venture Rewards card will earn you 2 points for every dollar you spend, regardless of what you spend it on. The United Explorer card will earn you 2 points for every dollar you spend on United purchases, dining, and hotels, and then 1 point for every dollar you spend on other purchases. And as we already discussed, Chase Sapphire Preferred will earn you 2 points for every dollar you spend on travel and dining, and then 1 point for every dollar you spend on other purchases. Once you've earned these credit card points, you'll be able to redeem them for free flights and hotels. The flights and hotels that you can redeem the points for will depend on each credit card. And later in this video, I'll walk you through an example of how to do this step by step. So what are the key tips that you need to know to start travel hacking? First tip, if you are completely brand new to the world of credit cards, the very first card you open should be one without an annual fee. I say this because one of the key factors affecting your credit score is the length of time your oldest account has been open. So because of this, you have to think of your very first credit card as your credit history anchor. This is a card that you'll want to keep open forever, regardless of whether you're spending on it or not. Because if you close this card, then chances are your credit score will go down, because by closing it, you're shortening the length of time your longest account has been open for. This is why I recommend that your first credit card be one without an annual fee, so that you'll happily keep it open forever as your credit history anchor. The second tip is the golden rule. Use your credit cards responsibly. The only way you're truly going to master the world of travel hacking is if you don't make these mistakes. By this, I'm thinking of two things. The first part of the rule is that you cannot carry any credit card debt. The reason these credit card companies are able to offer such lucrative sign-up bonuses in the first place is because for every person who pays off their statement balance in full each month, there's someone else out there who is carrying credit card debt and paying insane amounts of interest on that balance. The second part of the golden rule is that you cannot spend more than you would normally spend. This includes spending to meet sign-up bonuses. So if there's a credit card that requires you spend $3,000 in the first 3 months to meet the sign-up bonus, and you're normally already spending at least $1,000 a month on credit cards, then that's fine. But if, in order to meet the minimum spend required for a sign-up bonus, you'd have to spend more than you normally would, then I would not recommend signing up for that credit card. So before you sign up for any credit card, make sure that your normal spending will allow you to meet the minimum spend requirement for that sign-up bonus. I'm sure you know this, but credit cards need to be treated like cash. If you can't pay for it with cash, don't pay for it with a credit card. Travel hacking is all about saving you money on travel. But if in the process you're spending more than you normally would or racking up credit card debt, then you're completely negating any benefits of travel hacking. Tip number three is to know your goal for travel hacking. Is your goal to fly with a particular airline or stay at a particular hotel or go to a specific destination? This is something that you'll want to think about first because it'll affect which credit cards you'll want to start with. There's no one-size-fits-all strategy for travel hacking because a lot of it depends on your answers to those questions. Because I live in Tokyo, United points are very valuable to me. United is part of Star Alliance, so these United points get me access to my favorite Japanese carrier, All Nippon Airways, since they're also part of Star Alliance. This makes it very easy for me to book flights to and from Tokyo using these United points. Because of that, my strategy is to target credit cards that give me United points. So I have, or at one point had, the Chase Sapphire Preferred, Chase Sapphire Reserved, Chase Freedom Unlimited, United Explorer Card, and Inc. Business Preferred. These cards all allow me to transfer my credit card points directly into United points. A card like the Southwest card, on the other hand, would make no sense for me to have because I never fly Southwest. But it might make a lot of sense for you to have. So all this is to say that before you start travel hacking, you should know what your ultimate goal is. Whether it's to get points for a particular airline you fly a lot or stay in a hotel that you really like, because what makes sense for me might not necessarily make sense for you. Tip number four is to keep track of your credit cards. Especially as you get more into travel hacking, it's likely going to get more complex because you'll have multiple cards that you'll need to keep track of at any given time. Taking a step back, one of the terms that you'll hear a lot of people use when talking about travel hacking is credit card churning. Credit card churning is basically where you sign up for a new credit card in order to take advantage of the sign-up bonus, but then as soon as you meet that sign-up bonus, you cancel the card. You typically cancel the card within a few weeks prior to the one-year mark of that card being open, so that you don't have to pay the annual fee for the second year. Cards that you're opening just for the sign-up bonuses can be thought of as temporary cards. And then most credit card churners typically have a few cards that they always keep in their wallet. So these are thought of as long-term cards. I have three long-term cards, and then the rest are temporary. So back to keeping track of your credit cards. I keep track of my credit cards using a simple Excel sheet. I list the name of the credit card, the date I open that card, what the minimum spend requirement is, when I need to hit that minimum spend, the bonus I get when I hit that minimum spend, and if it's going to be a temporary card for me, then I also list the date I need to close it by. Also, if I know it's a temporary card for me and I'll want to close it within the year, then I'll go ahead and set alerts in my phone to remind me that I need to close it by that certain date. This is all really important to do because otherwise it's easy to lose track of your credit cards and you can make costly mistakes. Last year, there was one card that I opened that I wasn't vigilant about tracking. So I met the minimum spend requirement 1 day late. And that mistake cost me $500 since I didn't end up getting the sign-up bonus for that card. So if you're going to travel hack, it's very important to come up with a system to keep track of your cards and don't slack like I did that one time. Tip number 5 is to know which credit card to use for which purchase. When you start getting into using multiple credit cards, it'll be important to know which credit card to use for which purchase so that you can maximize the number of points that you're getting. Obviously, if I'm trying to meet the minimum spend requirement for a sign-up bonus, I'm putting all of my purchases on that new card, regardless of how many points I'll get for each purchase. But at other times, I have a strategy for which card I'll use for which purchase. This is because, as I mentioned earlier, a lot of cards have a point system where you're earning a different amount of points depending on the category of purchase. To take you through an example, given the cards that I have in my wallet now, if I'm spending on travel or dining, then I'm using my Chase Sapphire Reserve because that'll get me 3 times the points for every dollar that I spend on travel and dining. If I'm buying something at Starbucks, then I'm using my Chase Freedom Unlimited because they have a special offer right now where I'll get 10% back on any purchases at Starbucks. For things like Netflix, I'm putting that on my Capital One Venture Rewards card because that'll get me 2 points for every dollar I spend. So once you start having multiple cards, you should have a system in place like this so that you know exactly which card you're going to use for which purchase so that you can maximize the number of points that you're earning. Tip number 6 is to know what to redeem your points for. One of the biggest mistakes I see people make is redeeming their points for cash back. Cashback should be avoided because that's always going to be the least value for your points. Generally, you're going to get the most value for your points if you're transferring them to an airline or a hotel. But of course, there's strategy behind this too. I think the best way to demonstrate this is to take you through an example of the actual strategy that I'm using. And this will also give you a really good idea about how the entire process works from beginning to end. So just to give you a sense of how my process works for travel hacking, I'm going to take you step by step through a hypothetical. I went to Singapore earlier this year and I loved it. I want to go again next year. I know that Singapore Air has nonstop flights from Tokyo to Singapore, so I'm going to try to travel hack to get those flights for close to nothing. The first step is going to be to spend on the credit card. Chase lets me transfer points directly to Singapore Air and also to United, which is part of Star Alliance together with Singapore Air. So I want to be spending on my Chase cards for this goal. Once I've earned the points, then I begin my search. First, I'm going to head on over to the Singapore Air website and input my travel dates, which are March 7th through March 14th, a Saturday to Saturday. Actually, pro tip here, the best days to fly with points are usually Tuesdays and Wednesdays because those tend to be the least popular travel dates and therefore you'll find the most availability for flights with points. It's searching, and now I've found a nonstop economy round trip flight from Tokyo to Singapore for 50,000 miles and 7,650 yen, which is about $70, so I'll go ahead and write that down. Next, I want to check Singapore Air for business class. It looks like I can get a flight for business class for 94,000 miles and $70. Now I'm going to head on over to the United website because, as I mentioned, United is part of Star Alliance with Singapore Air, so there's a good chance I can find a Singapore Air flight using United miles. Since on Singapore Air, I found a nonstop economy round trip flight for 50,000 miles and $70, I'm looking to see if United can beat that. And sure enough, it does. A nonstop economy round trip flight on Singapore Air with United miles is just 40,000 miles and $69.80. With that, I'm feeling pretty happy because I found the same flight on United for 10,000 fewer miles. Next, I'm going to check United for the same flight in business class, and unfortunately, there's no nonstop business class flight available on United, so that's off the table. Taking a look at what I have right now, if I want to fly economy, then United is my best choice because I can get that for 40,000 miles and $70. If I want to fly business, then Singapore Air is my best choice because I can get that for 94,000 miles and $70. If my process stopped there, then I'd have to choose between economy and business. And in this case, I'm going to go with economy, so I need to use 40,000 miles on United. To do this, I'd head on over to my Chase portal, click transfer to travel partners, select my United account, and then transfer over the 40,000 miles. I'd get a confirmation email from Chase saying that my point transfer has been made, and usually it would take about a minute for those points to show up in my United account. Then I would purchase the flight on my United account. But there's a catch here. I haven't gone through my last step, which is to check how much the flights would cost if I bought them with cash and not points. Taking a look, that same economy flight is going to cost me $633. Then I'll do some simple calculations to figure out whether it's better to pay for my flight using cash or with points. The value of your points is going to vary between credit cards, but since we're using Chase in this example, I value my Chase points at least 2 cents per point. There's no hard rule on this, and actually a lot of travel websites will tell you that 1.5 cents per Chase point is good value, but since I've been doing this for so many years, I usually set my benchmark at 2 cents per point. In my mind, 2 cents per point justifies using the points. So if I'm not getting 2 cents per point in value, then I'm not going to use points. I'd rather use cash. So if I use points for this economy flight, it's going to be 40,000 points plus $70. If I use cash, it's going to be $633. So even with points, it's going to be $70 out of pocket for the taxes and fees. So first I'm going to subtract 70 from 633, to get 563. Now the question is if I'd rather spend $563 or use 40,000 points. So I'm going to divide 563 by 40,000 points. If I use the points, that means my points are going to be valued at 1.4 cents per point. As I mentioned before, I only want to use my Chase points if I'm getting at least 2 cents per point. So in this case, since I'm only getting 1.4 cents per point, it actually doesn't make sense for me to use my Chase points, and I'd rather use cash to pay for this flight. So I hope this was helpful. I hope actually walking you through these examples was informative. And if you have any questions at all, I seriously love talking about credit cards. So just comment below and I'll be sure to answer all of your questions. Also, please hit the like button and subscribe if you haven't already. It's really going to help this channel grow. Next week, I'll be talking about how I paid off over $200,000 in student loans in under 2 years. So be sure to come back next Tuesday to watch that video. Thank you for watching and have a great week.